Remember a school bell like that? I do. I'm Professor John Kienzle. How many of you have been with me before for some of the other adventures that we've had? Oh, terrific, fantastic. We did a Middle East lecture series a couple of years ago, actually we were about a year and a half or so, which of course covered places like Israel and Iran and Egypt and that whole Middle East question, which is still a very, very big thing in the papers. Second one that we did was last spring, which was on the Far East. And we had the honor of teaching about China and Japan and Korea and Southeast Asia, countries, for example, like Thailand and Laos and Vietnam. When we got done with that, people said, well, could you come back and do another series on another area of the world? And they seemed to want to hear more about Russia. So this is the beginning of a four-part series on Russia and her neighbors. I don't know about you, but when I was in school, the only thing I really knew much about Russia was that they were the enemy. They were the red communists. They were the communists, the red menace, the bad guys that were coming to get us, that kind of thing. But we really didn't know too much about Russia itself. If you think back, when you studied in school, you heard mostly about countries like France and England and Holland and Germany and Italy and Spain, countries from which most of us came, or our ancestors, immigrants coming over from Western Europe. That's basically what most of the curriculum was about. But obviously, once the Soviet Union got going in the 1920s, the fact was it became a major power in the world scene, and people had to know more about it. So tonight, what we're going to do is start the first of four lectures about Russia and her neighbors. Tonight's the one on Russia itself. How many of you get the bulletin? Do you get the bulletin, this COA Connections thing? Okay, if you get this bulletin, you can pick one up here if you stop in. Right on the front of it is the schedule, the calendar. That will remind you in case you forget. The first one we're going to do is on Russia itself, the country Russia. Now, you probably know that for many, many years, most of the 20th century, there was a country known as the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. We shortened that to be Soviet Union. That was made up of 15 different constituent republics. The biggest and greatest of them, of course, was Russia. But there were many other countries, or what we call countries now, which were part of the Soviet Union. They were called Soviet Socialist Republics, or SSRs. In 1991, when the Soviet Union broke up, 14 of those left the Soviet Union and became independent nations. Some of them stayed close to Russia in terms of economics and politics and diplomatic affairs, and some of them are really headed for the exit very fast. For example, the three little Baltic republics of Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, these that are right along the Baltic Sea, joined NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and the European Union, which is a Western European organization, economic organization, right away, much to the consternation of the Soviets, as you can imagine. So the fact is, the country we're looking at today is basically Russia. That's this part of it, this part here. In future lectures, I'll take a look at Eastern Europe and especially Ukraine. On the 5th of October, we'll do a lecture that will take a look at Russia's relationships with Eastern Europe, Poland, for example, the Ukraine. Recently, you know that the Soviets, the Russians rather, actually sent soldiers in to help the eastern section of Ukraine secede. There's a whole story in back of that. But effectively, they were trying to make sure that the Ukrainian government, the Ukrainian country, the nation of Ukraine, would be split, and that those people of Russian nationality who happened to be in the Ukraine would be kind of seceding or pulling away. A few months after that, as you know, they actually annexed the Crimea. The Crimea is an important peninsula here in the northern part of the Red Sea. Sevastopol is a big naval base that's been there for a long time. I will take a look at that on the 5th of October and try and explain why this was done and what the Russians had in mind in terms of getting into this sort of thing. Thirdly, on the 19th of October, we'll skip a week because of Columbus. My mother used to say, now, don't forget to tell everybody that Columbus was an Italian, even though he sailed for Spain. We will honor him with a day off on the 12th. But the 19th, we'll get together and take a look at the Baltics. That's Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, which are still very important countries. And since they are the liner of the eastern end of the Baltic Sea, one of the few accesses that Russia has to the open ocean. They are still very important to Russia, and the relations between them are still very significant. The 2nd of November, we'll take a look at the Caucasus. Now, the Caucasus is a general area right here between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea. Countries like Azerbaijan, Armenia, Georgia, the country of Georgia, and of course Chechnya. Some of you know that the Tsarnaev brothers, who bombed that terrible day in April, the marathon run, came from Chechnya. And Chechnya is a province which has been trying to get away from Russia for quite a long time, for at least a decade or so. So we'll take a look at the Caucasus countries, which have, if you will, their own agendas, their own ways of doing things, and some of them are fairly close to Russia, and some of them do not want to have anything to do with the Russians. In fact, several of them in the Caucasus are considering joining the European Union. Now, I wanted to tell you about that as we start out. Secondly, I'm going to pass around to you some pictures. I didn't want to do one of those PowerPoint things, click, 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 click. You know, those things put me to sleep, and I don't know if you're that way, but I wanted to avoid trying to just do a slideshow in front of you. But I'll pass these pictures around because they touch on areas and places and people which we'll be talking about tonight. Of course, most of you recognize St. Basil's. This is one of the most beautiful, beautiful churches in Russia. I know most people don't think of Russia as being a religious country, but it really is. The Russian Orthodox Church has been around for a long, long time. Of course, under Soviet communism, people were taught that that religion was the opiate of the masses, to quote Marx, Communist Manifesto book that he wrote, and that essentially religion was just a fairy tale that was told to people to keep them under control. But the churches and things that were built back in the old days are still there, and some of them are really quite extraordinary. This was built, by the way, with these lovely, beautiful cone-like domes during the time of one of the czars. His name was Ivan IV. He was known as Ivan the Terrible. He did a lot of terrible things. For example, when they finished building this, he had the architects and the artisans who had built this blinded so that they would never again create anything of this beauty. St. Basil's, rather. The Hermitage. How many of you ever traveled to Russia? Okay, where did you go?
St. Petersburg.
St. Petersburg. Most people go to St. Petersburg or Moscow, you know, the main cities. But St. Petersburg is known especially for a marvelous museum that was collected by and put together by Catherine. Yeah, there were some great czars. Catherine the Great. Catherine, by the way, wasn't Russian. She was German. She was imported to create heirs for the Russian line. But she became more Russian than the Russians themselves. One of the things she wanted to do was to bring some culture into Russia. At that time, let's face it, Russia was somewhat behind in the cultural world. So she literally spent millions and millions and millions of rubles, dollars if you will, to bring in the most extraordinary art, sculpture and painting and all those things. And the museum that still stands today is called the Hermitage. Did you visit it? What did you think?
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable, yeah. It ranks along with the Louvre.
Gilded.
Yeah, gilded. Everything was gold. It's everywhere you look. It ranks along with the Louvre and the Metropolitan Museum of Art and the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, the BFA, as one of the greatest museums in the world. Thought I'd pass that around to you, too. Here's a picture of the Kremlin. The Kremlin, of course, is a fortress, okay? It was originally built to be able to withstand attacks from nomadic tribesmen, Mongols, and others that were coming in. It's now become the center of the Russian government, has been for a long time. Every once in a while in the papers, it'll say, the Kremlin announced. Well, obviously, the building isn't speaking. It's the government that's housed therein. But the Kremlin picture over there, here's a Russian Orthodox priest and the Russian Orthodox Church that's still there. I'll tell you some more about that. Probably most famous of the architects of Russian communism was Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov. He took the pseudonym Lenin because in his time, you know, to stir up trouble against the Tsar was a treasonable offense. You could get killed or imprisoned for that. So he used the code name Lenin. Well, this is a picture of Lenin's tomb. It is still a place of pilgrimage for people who are interested in communism and the communist theory. And there is Vladimir himself. He's still in a glass case, so you can see him for all time. Vladimir Putin, obviously the current president of Russia, very, very powerful man. Some people call him the new czar. I'll tell you some more about him as we go along. This guy is Boris Nemtsov. The reason I tell you about him is because a few months ago, Boris Nemtsov is a very vocal critic of the Putin administration and the things that Putin was doing, especially the invasion there, if you will, of Ukraine and the annexation of the Crimea. Nemtsov was mysteriously shot by hoodlums while crossing a bridge in Moscow. Nobody really knows who did it. Well, they arrested a couple of fellows who happened to be conveniently Chechens, by the way. And whether or not they really assassinated this fellow for what reason, no one knows. Or whether Putin himself or someone in his entourage decided to get rid of him because he was creating quite an international stir with his criticisms of Putin. But I give you a picture of him. Gorbachev, recognize that name? Okay, Mikhail Gorbachev was the first person, if you will, in the communist lineup, if you will, to try and make some real fundamental changes in the Soviet government. He espoused what was called glasnost, openness, and perestroika, which means to reorganize, to restructure the government. Well, he did it so well that, in fact, when he got done in December of 1991, the Soviet government actually folded. They couldn't function anymore. And glasnost and perestroika actually led to the collapse of the Soviet Union. In Russia, Gorbachev is seen as both a savior, someone who got them out of the usual Soviet communism, and also as a person who demolished a system that everyone had been taught was perfect. Nikita Khrushchev, remember him? He's the guy that banged his shoe on the podium at the United Nations, okay? We will bury you, he said to the world. In other words, our system of communism will prevail and you guys will be buried. And, well, I guess he wore out more shoes doing that. But Nikita Khrushchev was also a very, very strong proponent of Russia, of the Soviet Union, as being a major power. He's the one, for example, who challenged the United States in 1962 with what came to be known as the Cuban Missile Crisis. At that time, many countries in the world had become client states of Russia, of the Soviet Union, one of which was Cuba, and Cuba was a very, very good place to put missiles on because it was right under the nose of the United States. Probably some of you remember that time. I'll tell you some stories about that. But there's a picture of Khrushchev. There's also some political cartoons about Putin because he's quite a good target for that sort of thing. And let's see what else we've got here. Oh, yes, I wanted you to see the European Union, okay, how many countries are involved in the European Union. And also, I wanted you to see the countries that are in the NATO organization, which is in here someplace. There's NATO, okay. The fact is that during the Cold War, especially right after World War II, the Soviet Union felt that they were going to be threatened by the West, and they created what came to be known as the Warsaw Pact. Countries like Poland and Czechoslovakia and Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria were all part of that. And essentially, they felt that it was necessary to counteract NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, which had been put together after World War II to protect the freedoms that have been so dearly won in the war. I wanted you to see how the Russians can see themselves as being surrounded. Whenever trouble has come to Russia in its history, it's usually come from the West. Sweden, for example, Napoleon Bonaparte, remember in 1812, Hitler, for example, in World War II, who first signed a non-aggression pact with Stalin and then later on broke it. It's usually been from the West. So I think you can understand, maybe not agree with, but understand why the Russians would be kind of paranoid about the Western powers, and especially about organizations like NATO, which they see essentially as a threat. Putin is not by himself. This little chart came out about a month ago in Time magazine. And what it does is it shows the advisors and the circle of people who are directly around him. What's happened in the last 2 years or so is that the moderate elements, and there were moderate elements in the inner circle of Putin's government, have been kind of pushed out further and further and further away. And more of the conservative, if you will, aggressive advisors have come to be, have gotten Putin's ear. Some people believe that this is a sign that overall Russia will continue to be more aggressive in the future. I wanted you to see the who's who of who these people are. By the way, down here, look at that. Patriarch Kirill, head of the Russian Orthodox Church. That's right. One of Putin's advisors is the head of the Russian Orthodox Church. During the time of the Soviet Union, as I said, religion was suppressed. It was the opiate of the masses. Once the Soviet Union crashed in 1991, the fact was things changed. The churches reopened. St. Basil's, which had been a museum, that's right, a museum, to show the art of this, this time when people believed in all these fairy tales, was now opened as a regular church. The churches remained to be packed every single day of the week in Russia today. And the seminaries and the nunneries, there are seminaries for priests and nunneries and places where they, convents where they train the nuns, cannot keep up with the applications of young men and women who want to become religious. Can you imagine that? Now, doesn't that tell you something, that you can try and oppress a people, take away their faith, and tell them to worship the state, but in the long run, it doesn't seem to work, okay? I wanted you to see that, but knowing Putin, Putin's no dummy, he wants to make sure that he keeps the church with him, okay? That's why this picture, which just appeared about a week ago, I thought was really quite significant. There's Putin giving a speech right in front of St. Basil's. And I thought, wow, what a contrast there. You have the head of the Russian government, ostensibly a communist, or at least a reformed one, right by the figurine of a church that has been around for a long time, which symbolizes the old Russia. So old and new, if you will. Let me pass these around. I'll start them right here. When they get all the way back to you, pass them over so that people can see. Okay? We've got time, and I wanted you to have a chance to look at those things up close. I've introduced myself. I'm Professor John Kienzle. I did my bachelor's degree at Albany State University and my MA, my master's degree at NYU. My doctorate is at Princeton University. I couldn't begin to afford the front doorknob of those places, but I studied and studied and studied, and I got scholarships because I was interested and willing to study areas of the world. At that time, many people, you know, American history, Western European history, dime a dozen. But hardly anybody was interested in studying Middle East, or Far East, or Russia, or China, or places like that. So I was able to get a good education, and I'm going to put all that to use with you tonight. We, of course, want to thank the folks here at the Bedford COA, the Council on Aging, especially Wendy Aronson. You met Wendy. Most of you know her. She's the director of the program department here. They have a new director here overall. Her name is Allison Chervensky. I don't know if you had a chance to meet her, but both of these folks work very, very hard to create and put on all kinds of wonderful programs for you. We also want to thank Bedford Television. Ace videographer Brian Dorrington is here tonight, and Brian's going to make a video copy of this, and I think you run it actually on the local cable channel. So if you want to see an instant replay, you can tune in and get a chance to look at that. Please turn off your cell phones, electronic devices, and other kinds of things, but not your hearing aids, please. We do want you to be able to hear what's going on. There are restrooms right down around the corner here. If you have to go, just get up and go. I won't be insulted. I was a high school teacher for 36 years. 36 years teaching world history. And it was my duty to write a bathroom pass every time a kid wanted to go to the toilet. But I will essentially leave that go for tonight. And if you have to go, you go right ahead for that. Handouts. Besides signing in, thank you for doing that, because I will get a severe beating if you didn't. I have two handouts here for you. One is a map. It became very clear to me in my training as a teacher that especially when you talk about history or political science, that geography is very, very important. I put up some maps here, but the fact is I wanted you to have something in your hand that it will give you a closer look at what we're looking at here. This is a vast, extraordinary country. 9 time zones okay? 1/6 of all the habitable land on the earth is in the country of Russia. To give you an idea, so I give you a map here to give you a rough idea of where things are. Now, don't worry, there's not going to be a quiz on it, but I wanted you to see, basically, the geographic layout of this country. This is a huge, immense country with all kinds of geographic features in it. Most of you have heard of the Ural Mountains or Siberia or some of the desert regions to the south. This is an immense land, and that's why I gave you the map. The second thing is a suggested reading list. If you've been with me before, you know that every time I give a lecture, I usually get out a list. When I was a high school teacher, it was like pulling teeth to get my students to read. They just did not want to read. But I know you guys are senior citizens, and you were trained at a time when reading was a good thing. And many of you probably still do read in your off time when you get a chance. If you want to learn more, I can only say so much between now and 8:30 tonight. If you want to learn more, this gives you an idea of the books that I recommend to you. There are thousands and thousands of books out there about Russia, about the Soviet Union, about communism. Keep in mind that some books that are out there are, if you will, they have an axe to grind. They have a perspective. They have a point of view. As a historian, I know that there are two sides to every question. And my professors drummed into me, always try to cover both sides. Try to look at things from the other guy's point of view. So I tried to pick books that were as even as possible to give you a perspective about Russia. First one, Nothing is True and Everything is Possible, Surreal Heart of the New Russia. Peter put together, Peter Pomerantsev put together a very, very nice collection of essays which look at all the different aspects of Russia today. The economy, the social life, the media, all of those things. And it's a very, very fascinating book if you want to take a look at the perspective of what's happening now. Wheel of Fortune, The Battle for Oil and Power in Russia. Did you know that Russia is one of the greatest powers of oil? Producers of oil in the world. When you think oil, what do you think? Saudi Arabia, right? Iran, maybe Kuwait, maybe Indonesia, Nigeria. Fact is, Russia has a tremendous amount of oil and natural gas, which they use as leverage against other countries, sometimes trying to keep them under control by levering how much they're going to be able to get. The Baltic countries, for example, buy a lot of gas, natural gas, from the Russians. And the Russians have a very strong hold on the tap. You know, if you say or do something they don't like, whoop, tap just closed. Gee, too bad. The gas lines broke there. You know, that sort of thing. Putin's kleptocracy. Who owns Russia? Probably some of you know the kleptomania is just stealing. Well, the fact is that most of the Russian economy today, yes, is under civilian control rather than the central economic planning that they used to have under the Soviet Union. But, of course, it's in the hands of a very small oligarchy of buddies of Putin. And this talks about Putin's kleptocracy. Who owns Russia? Who's actually got their hands on the major producer items? The industries, the agriculture, the other areas. Ruling Russia, authoritarianism from the revolution to Putin. One of the fundamental things about Russia you should know is that for a long, long, long time, going back at least 1,000 years, the Russians have been usually ruled by a single authoritarian power. Call it a czar, call it a president of the presidium, call it the whatever, the fact is they're used to being under an authoritarian or autocracy of some sort. And this takes a look at what happened from the revolution, that's 1917, up to the time of Putin. Notice it comes from Princeton University Press. That's my alma mater, so I always give a little plug there for things that come out of Princeton. Yale does some good things too, by the way. Not as good as Princeton, but pretty good. The Strong Man, Vladimir Putin and the Struggle for Russia, number 5, that's specifically about Putin himself. There isn't a whole lot of information. You have to understand that in Russia, they don't publish everything. I mean, you can tell what President Obama had for breakfast yesterday. It's in the papers. You know, I mean, everything is published, published, published. The fact is, though, with Putin, a lot of information is not necessarily put out there for people to know about. This book, essentially, is one of the best ones I've seen that tries to analyze the man, tell you about his background. He was a lieutenant colonel in the KGB, the secret police, if you will, in East Germany for many years. His background is in intelligence and espionage. Just to give you a little bit of background there. Putin's wars, the rise of Russia's new imperialism, that business in eastern Ukraine, for example, the annexation of the Crimea. In recent years, in fact, in the last year or so, the Russians have increased their overflight with their long-range aircraft into areas where they usually were not. Their submarines have appeared in places that we have not seen in 10 or 15 years at least. There's an awful lot going on, and the Russians are beginning to push and push and push in all different directions, not just in the West, but even out in the East. The Japanese, for example, have been tracking their Russian submarines all up and down their coast, and this has made people very, very nervous about that. Seven, a people's tragedy, that's specifically about the Russian Revolution. Actually, there's been several revolutions in Russia. The big one, of course, is the one in 1917 when the last Tsar was overthrown and a small political party known as the Bolsheviks, led by Lenin, was able to actually seize control of the government and create the first actual communist state. Up to that time, let's face it, communism was just a theory. You know, Marx and Lenin, the Communist Manifesto, nobody had ever taken those ideas and really made them or tried to make them into a government. Well, the revolution tried to do that, and the result was what we call the Soviet Union, which lasted really from 1922 all the way to 1991. As an experiment, politically, economically, it ultimately failed. But they sure as heck gave it a try, and they made modifications, major modifications, along the way. This is A People's Tragedy, number 7. Because what this book does is it tries to look at what happens during the revolution from a person's perspective. How did it affect a farmer? How did it affect a factory worker? How did it affect someone who worked in a shop? Urban versus rural populations, that kind of thing. The common people. I know when you read books about history, you almost always hear about the big shots, you know, the czars and the presidents and the generals. Well, what about the average folks like us? What happened to them as a result? Number 7 gets into that. Number 8, resurrection, the struggle for a new Russia. There is a strong feeling in Russia today that Mother Russia should rise again, that they had been humiliated, really. After the fall of the Soviet Union from 1991 on, their economy tanked terribly. Their prestige internationally was really down the tubes. Militarily, they had to withdraw an awful lot of their submarines and a lot of their extensive military forces that had been stationed around the world. In other words, they had to shrink considerably. And many of the Russian insiders believe that now is the time, now in the 2014, 15, 16, going to 2020, it's time for Mother Russia to stand up and be a great power again, whatever it takes. Stalin, number 9. If there's one character that you want to read about, Stalin is it. He is a tremendously interesting fellow. Of course, very strict, very brutal. He's the one that invented the Gulag Archipelago, the old jokes about being sent off to Siberia. This was no joke. It really happened. Millions and millions of people who dared to argue against Stalin and his policies were shipped eastward out into Siberia to these work camps and other areas, some of whom survived and some of whom did not. But that's the book on Stalin there, I think one of the best ones ever written. It's a 2002, but there again, you know, there's hundreds of books about Stalin. I think that's the best one available currently right now. And last one, number 10, Russia, A Long View. If you want to get an overall panoramic view of Russia from the early days up to now, what's happening, that number 10 book would be good for you. By the way, the little funny numbers there, the ISBN numbers, those are the identification numbers for those particular books. When you go to a bookstore or Barnes & Noble's, or you go online and you try and find a particular book, sometimes if you misspell it by one letter, the computer will not know what you're talking about. But if you know the ISBN, that's the International Standard Book Number, that number identifies that book and only that book. And if you want to find a particular book, the fastest way to do it is to put the ISBN number in. That's why I give you that number, because that'll help you identify.
Yeah, libraries too.
What's that?
Libraries.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Yep. That'd be the way to find what you might be looking for. Questions anytime. Now, you said that you've been to Russia. Some of you have been there, St. Petersburg, Moscow, that kind of thing. If you want to chime in and say something or interrupt me or ask a question, please, by all means, please do that. I wanted to tell you about two other things before I get into the actual formal lecture part. There's a lot of things out there that you could go to that are close by. Have you ever, any of you ever heard of the Museum of Russian Icons? Yeah, okay. It's in Clinton, Massachusetts. Right, Clinton, Massachusetts, not very far away, 203 Union Street. They have a terrific collection of some of the most exquisite Russian art. Icons are religious pictures. And in the Russian Orthodox Church, in the Greek Orthodox Church too, religious pictures are venerated, pictures of Mary and Jesus and the saints, that kind of thing. And these icons are of extraordinary quality. They even have icons from other places like Ethiopia. Okay, Ethiopia is a Christian nation, by the way. They're the first of the African countries to take on Christianity as a national faith. But if you want to go and see it, it's at 203 Union Street in Clinton, Massachusetts. I understand it's about 40 miles away, exit 27 off of 495 South. So if you want exact directions or anything like that, go and see it. It's a fantastic place. They have a library. They have a rooftop terrace for outdoor dining, if you like, even a Russian tea room. It's really quite extraordinary, so if you want to try that. In November 6 and 7, there's going to be what's called the Bazaar Rus, Slavic food and crafts, Friday, November 6 and Saturday, November 7, Slavic foods, crafts, Russian nesting dolls, you know, little dolls that fit inside of each other, crafts, Orthodox icons, books, that sort of thing. It's being held at the Holy Annunciation Orthodox Church, which is in Maynard. Anybody know where Maynard is? Maynard, Massachusetts, right? Okay, so if that's something coming up in November. If you want more details, just stop and ask me, and I'll give you some more details on that. I have the address of the church and everything, too. I brought some flags with me. This is the Russian flag nowadays. For many years, it was a red flag. It had the hammer and sickle on it to symbolize communism. Now, they have a white, blue, and red. Isn't that interesting? Red, white, and blue. Actually, the flag dates back to the time of Peter the Great. Peter the Great was very interested in opening up a window on the west and in building a navy. That's right, a Russian navy. And the flag was originally invented to be an ensign that the Russian ships would carry. Nowadays, they use this flag, as opposed to the old one with the red and the hammer and sickle, as a symbol for Russia itself. The other constituent republics, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, the ones down here in the Caucasus and so forth, they all have separate flags nowadays. But this is the Russian flag. The white is supposed to symbolize generosity and frankness, the blue, loyalty and honesty, the red, courage and love. You notice also, if you know anything about international flags, it's very similar to the Dutch flag. You ever seen the flag of Holland or the Netherlands? Okay. The reason for that is, did you know Peter the Great actually went to Western Europe? When he became Tsar, he realized that his country was terribly behind. And so he decided that he would actually go to Western Europe, not as the Tsar of all the Russians, but as a shipwright. That's right, as a carpenter. He traveled all over Europe, and he was especially fascinated by the Dutch shipbuilders. He spent a year and a half actually physically working in the shipyards of the Dutch Republic at that time, learning how they built their ships. And of course, while he was there, he also saw a lot of the Western European customs. Imagine men and women dancing together. You know, a lot of mind-blowing things that were completely different from what I think was going on in Russia. And therefore, as a result, when he came back to his country, he made some magnificent reforms, some terrific changes. Some people believe the reason why he picked those colors was because the Dutch flag is very much like that, the flag of the Netherlands. What are we talking about? I gave you a map. Consider 6.6 million square miles. That's about twice the size of the United States, including Alaska, Hawaii, the U.S. Virgin Islands, and Guam, Puerto Rico. The largest nation in the world, 1/8 of the Earth's inhabitable area is in the country of Russia. It's larger than Canada and China combined. China and Canada are the next larger countries in the world, as you probably know. 9 time zones and a wide range of landforms. Who are the people? Well, we call them Russian. The word Russian comes from the word Rus. These are my key terms, the things that I use as I'm teaching so that you can see the names. Rus means red-headed, because the earliest people to come into what is now Russia were Vikings. They were known as Varangians, probably from Sweden or perhaps Denmark. But they were known as the Rus, and as a result, the country name came from that, the Russians. About 81% of the people of Russia are actually ethnically speaking Russian. Population, 146 million people. Now, that might sound like a whole lot of people, but when you consider the United States has 315 million. 146 million people spread over this much territory is very, very thin. Obviously, the higher concentrations of populations are in the West. But as you get further and further east, down into Siberia, it is very, very sparsely populated as well. There are other people that are in Russia who are not Russian ethnically. Tatars, for example. Yes, Ukrainian people. Bashkirs, for example. Chechens and others. The official language is Russian. But 35 other languages are recognized by the Russian government. When you go to school in Russia, you must learn Russian. But you might speak Chechen or Armenian or Azerbaijani or something else at home because of the ethnic group that you might belong to. The government is called a federal semi-presidential republic. They have a two-house legislature, like our Congress, a federal council known as the upper house, like our Senate, a state Duma, D-U-M-A, state Duma, that's their, like their House of Representatives. So they do have that representative set up. Vladimir Putin is the current president now, and his prime minister is Dmitry Medvedev. Medvedev and Putin. It's known as a tandemocracy. The reason for that is when Putin was president, Medvedev was prime minister. When Medvedev became president, Putin was prime minister. When Putin was prime minister, when Medvedev was president, Putin was the prime minister. Then the next step, Putin got elected again, and Medvedev became prime minister. They go back and forth, back and forth. They've been doing this for about 10 years now, since the middle of the 2000s. So it is a country that is still dominated by a small group of people. Economy, ninth in the world by gross domestic product. That's about $2 trillion in our money. PCI about 14,317, which is 53rd in the world. Mineral and energy resources are immense, especially oil and natural gas. Agricultural resources, wheat, sugar, potatoes, vegetables, the third largest grain exporter in the world, behind Canada and Australia. Big fishing industry, for example, and they fish the entire world. I'm from Long Island originally. Any of you from Long Island? Okay, I'm from Patchogue, Long Island, which is about 60 miles out on the eastern shore of Long Island. If you go all the way out to the east end of the island, there's a place called Montauk Point. There's a beautiful lighthouse there, right? And I am a sailor. I love to sail sailboats. And in the summertime, we would go out to Montauk, we'd rent a sailboat, and we'd sail out into the ocean, to the Atlantic Ocean. This is a great adventure, as young men like to do. I'm also a ham radio operator. Anybody a ham here? I'm W-A-2-U-O-N. And I know something about radio and antennas. And it's a funny thing, because you get about 15 or 20 miles out, and guess what you see? Russian trawlers. Lots and lots and lots of Russian trawlers. Fishing. Yet, those trawlers had more antennas on them than NASA. You know what I'm saying? And more antennas than they would need to just talk back and forth to each other or to the mothership that would can the crop that they got, the catch that they got that day. In other words, the Russians also use their fishing fleets for intelligence gathering. They would especially like to watch the American submarines going in and out of New London, Connecticut, for example. So they are involved in fishing. They are involved in agriculture and other kinds of things as well. Historical summary. We could be here easily until Thursday if I went through every single thing I can tell you about Russian history. What I'm going to do, though, is courageously edit, okay, and tell you the things that are important in Russian history that have a bearing on what's been going on the 20th and 21st century. Early periods, the ancestors were Slavic tribes. You've seen the word Slavic. These are groups of people from Eastern Europe, and some of them moving northward from the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea. By the 7th century AD, there's a series of nomadic invasions. The Huns, the Avars, the Khazars kept coming in over 300 years until the 10th century AD. The story of Russia begins with what we call the Kievan Rus. A small kingdom was established, a miniature kingdom, by Varangians, by Vikings, around the city of Kiev, okay, what we now call Kiev. Some Russians pronounce it Kiev, but it's Kiev in American English. And from the Baltic area, Rurik was their first leader, established his headquarters at a place called Novgorod, and later on his successor Oleg conquered Kiev. They established a kingdom there, and there was a golden age in those days in the 10th and the 11th centuries. You may have heard of Vladimir the Great, 980 to 1015, Yaroslav the Wise from 1019 to 1054. At that time, the Russians took on Byzantine Christianity. Byzantine, from Byzantium, from Constantinople, sent missionaries up the rivers, going northward into what is now the area of Kiev. Two of those missionaries were called Cyril and Methodius. Now, when Cyril and Methodius got into Russian territory, they realized that they had a really big problem. You see, the Russians couldn't read Greek. In fact, they couldn't read their own language. It hadn't been written down. Russian was an oral language, but there was no alphabet. So they invented what we call the Cyrillic alphabet. That's why when you see Russian written, it doesn't look like the Western alphabet, the A, B, C, D, E, F, G, the Roman alphabet. It has its own alphabet. That alphabet was invented by Cyril and Methodius, those monks, in order to be able to put the Bible into a form that Russian people could read. This is when the beginning of the Russian Orthodox Church, first the Greek Orthodox, and then, of course, they converted it into what they wanted to have for themselves, the Russian Orthodox Church. Gradually, this wonderful golden age of Kievan Russia collapsed. There were Mongol invasions in 1237 and 1240. The Mongols, together with the Kumans, the Kipchaks, and the Bulgars, these are other groups of people that came in, collectively came to be known as the Tatars, the Golden Horde, as they were called. And they ruled for 200 years until the Battle of Kulikovo in 1380. Kulikovo is a terrific battle at which the Golden Horde, these Mongols, were finally defeated by the Russians, by the Russian forces. And the yoke had been lifted, they felt, from them. Later on, things began to move northward into what we now call Moscow. And Moscow declared itself to be a grand duchy. Moscow absorbed the smaller principalities, including Novgorod, and there rose among them a fellow named Ivan III, Ivan the Great, 1462 to 1505. Now, if you're not good at remembering dates, that's okay. Figure about the time of Columbus. Columbus is 1492. About that time, Ivan the Great was actually pulling together a Russian state around the city of Moscow. Ivan III took the title of Grand Duke of all the Russians, and he built up that fortress known as the Kremlin. The idea to be able to protect themselves from invading forces that might come. About this time also, in the year 1453, just before Ivan III, Constantinople fell to the Ottoman Empire. Moscow claimed the legacy of the Eastern Roman Empire, and they called themselves the Third Rome. Probably some of you know the First Rome is in Italy, the Rome of the Roman Empire. When the Roman Empire was conquered and fell in the year 476 AD, the loci, the center of the Roman world, shifted east to what came to be known as Constantinople, named after Constantine the Great. And for 1,000 years, until 1453, the Byzantine Empire, based around Constantinople, held the Roman tradition together. They also used the Greek Orthodox Church as their religious core. Okay? In the year 1453, it was the 29th of May, a little after 8 o'clock in the morning. It was raining that day. Yeah. It was. The lead elements of the Ottoman army under Mehmed II, who's known as Fatih Sultan Mehmed in Turkish, came over the walls and actually seized the city of Constantinople and converted it to what we now call as Istanbul. With the collapse of Constantinople, the Russians felt that, well, therefore the, if you will, the mantle of the Roman Empire, the Roman civilization, should pass to them. And so they took up the name the Third Rome and decided that they would be the center, they believed, of that cultural inheritance. Grand Duke Ivan IV, Ivan the Terrible, crowned himself Tsar. That's where we get the name Tsar. Tsar is a corruption of the word Caesar. Where does Caesar come from? The Romans, of course. So he crowned himself emperor in the year 1547. He did do some good things. I know he's called terrible because of a lot of the terrible things he did, but he did do some good things. A new code of law was promulgated in 1550. He decided that there should be a representative body to assist him in governing the country, which came to be known as the Zemsky Sobor. Local self-government in the rural areas was allowed. He annexed huge areas to the east, going further and further and further east into what we now call Siberia. By the end of the 16th century, by the end of the 1500s, Russia is a multi-ethnic, multi-denominational, transcontinental state. It's a huge country by this time. Now, also during this time, there was a series of wars in the West. I mention it now because we'll get into it when we talk about the Baltics. Poland and Lithuania and Sweden. If you take a look at a map of Europe, Poland, of course, is here, Lithuania here, Sweden over here. The three of them actually conspired to move eastward and to try and take as much territory as they could from the Russians, which they considered to be inferior and able to be conquered. Of course, they wanted to prevent the Russians from getting access to the Baltic Sea. This is known as the Livonian War. Now, keep in mind that Poland and Lithuania were both Catholic countries. And so there is an element of religious collision here between the Russian Orthodox Church and the Catholic countries. And in those days, Lithuania and Poland was actively pushing to try and push the Catholic religion into Russia. They were not successful. But for quite a while, they gave the Russians a rough time for their money. Part of Moscow was actually burned in 1571. The last of Ivan's sons died in 1598. And from 1598 to 1613, there's a time period of 15 years. It's called the Time of Troubles. During that time, there is no czar. There is no central authority. The Swedes and the Lithuanians and the Poles are pushing in from the west. They've got troubles coming up from the south, from the Tatars, who are pushing in from the southern regions here in the Crimea and the Black Sea. By that time, the Ottoman Empire was becoming very, very strong. They had a tremendous sultan known as Suleiman the Magnificent, who was sultan from 1520 to 1566. The fact is they were surrounded by what they considered to be hostile powers pushing in on them. In the year 1613, after 15 years of this chaos, this time of troubles, the Zemsky Sobor, this deliberative assembly that was put together by Ivan, decided that they would settle on one of the ruling families, one of the principal families of Russia, to become the fountain from which further czars would come. These are the Romanovs. And that's why the czars from 1613 all the way to Nicholas II are of the Romanov dynasty. Okay, the Romanovs actually had a certain amount of connection with Germany. Okay, in terms of familiar boundaries and connections geographically and biologically as well. The Romanov dynasty then becomes the dynasty to rule Russia from 1613 all the way to 1917. Now, I'm not going to take you through every single czar, but there are a couple we've got to mention. Peter the Great, I told you his story, had actually gone to Western Europe and been a shipwright, physically laboring to learn the Western ways and especially how to build ships. Russia was proclaimed an empire. Peter ruled from 1682 to 1725. Now, if you think about that in American history, that's the very, very beginning of our colonial period at that time, okay? He defeated the Swedes. Probably some of you just think of Sweden as a place where it's a nice place to go and ski or something. But the fact is, Sweden at that time was a major superpower. They had a really crackerjack king. His name was King Charles X. And if you want to read some really good history that comes out of the Scandinavian area, or if you know anybody who's Swedish, they can tell you lots of stories about Charlie X, because he was very, very famous and a very good leader. Peter defeated him and therefore got access to this eastern end of the Baltic Sea. This was a major thing for him, because remember, he was interested in opening up conduits to the West. He is the one who built the city of St. Petersburg. It was called the Window on the West. He wanted to make sure that there was an actual access from Russia to come into the Baltic and therefore into the North Sea, and from the North Sea to the Atlantic, and have more of a contact with that. He was interested in developing a navy. That's right, an actual Russian navy. St. Petersburg was a swamp when he started. It took him 25 years to actually put the city together. But once it was there, St. Petersburg became a terrific capital. In fact, for many years, it was the capital of Russia, forsaking Moscow in some respects. Many reforms, opening up Russia to Western European cultural influences. His daughter, Elizabeth, who ruled from 1741 to 1762, participated in what we call the Seven Years' War. We call it the French and Indian War. You might remember that, 1754 to 1763 in this country. Well, in Europe, it was a war basically between the Prussians and the Russians. And the English were involved too. Well, in this case, they actually defeated the Prussians and occupied Eastern Prussia for a while. We've got another great one coming, 1762 to 96. For more than 34 years, Catherine II, known as Catherine the Great, presided over what came to be known as the Great Age of Russian Enlightenment. She is the one who built the Hermitage, this incredible museum that you've seen. And if you ever go online, or even if you have a chance to visit it, it's the most extraordinary thing. I've seen the Louvre in France. I've seen the Metropolitan, the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. I've seen some tremendous museums. But in my opinion, nothing holds a candle to the Hermitage. It is just extraordinary. Now, besides that, she was also involved in the partitions of Poland, the subjugation of Lithuania, driving southward into the Black Sea, and even fighting and winning over the Persians in the Caucasus. So Catherine was not just a wonderful cultural icon type person. She was also a very practical politician. By the way, Catherine wasn't really Russian. She was a German princess who was imported by Paul's, Paul was the czar at the time, by Paul's mother to bear children. What happened was that Paul was, how shall I say, mentally deficient. He played with soldiers when he was 25 years old, drooled, you know, not very good. And eventually, Paul didn't make it very long. Catherine stepped in, and she became a greater Russian than the Russians themselves. She learned the Russian language. She learned their culture, their heritage, everything, and was an extraordinary leader, Catherine II. Alexander I, 1801 to 1825, Finland is taken from Sweden. They lost, they took territory called Moldova from the Ottomans in 1812. The Russians colonized Alaska and founded settlements in California. If you ever look under the name Fort Ross, there's actually settlements that are being archaeologically discovered along the west coast of the United States and up into Alaska that were Russian. I think it was Seward's Folly. I remember hearing in American history class, Secretary of State Seward actually bought Alaska from the Russians. Everybody thought that was a crazy thing to do. Why would you buy an icebox? You know, why would you buy Seward? Well, obviously that turned out to be a pretty good bargain. Now, at the same time, remember, this is early 1800s. Well, who's going throughout Europe? Napoleon. Now, there again, Napoleon fought most of his battles in Western Europe, and then his eyes turned eastward. He said, wow, this is going to be a pushover. Those Russians are nothing. I'll just send the Grand Armée in there. We'll have them done in no time. Well, you know what happened. Father, or shall we say, General Winter defeated the French. The French got into territories in Russia, and when the winter came, they were not able to survive. They were not able to win the necessary battles to get into the cities to be able to survive the winter, and the winter drove them back. The Grand Army of Napoleon struggled back into Europe with less than one-third of its actual force that had started out in the beginning. Some of you who are music people might recognize the overture, the 1812 Overture by Tchaikovsky. Right, which has those bells and the cannons firing and so forth. This is to symbolize the victory of the Russians over France. And if you listen carefully to the 1812 Overture, you'll hear the Marseillaise. being played through it. It's mixed together to show the French side and the Russian, and of course the bells are the ones that were rung in the belfries throughout Moscow when Napoleon's forces finally gave up and went home. So this is another one of those things when the Russians lucked out. Alexander, in fact, headed Russia's delegation to the Congress of Vienna in 1815 to try and secure their western flank. Nicholas I is 1825 to 55, conservative reign. There's actually a revolt called the Decembrist Revolt in 1825, trying to decrease the Tsar's powers. Does not work. They also get involved in a war, the Crimean War, 1853 to 1856, and they were defeated in that as well. The fact is, Nicholas's reign from 1825 to 55 was not very good, and it was very, very conservative. You're going to find out that Russian history is like a big pendulum. It seems to swing back and forth from very conservative and ultra-controlling to more and more and more liberalism, and then back to the conservative. Back and forth, back and forth. In this particular case, Nicholas the First represents the conservative. His son, Alexander the Second, comes later, 1855 to 81, terrific reforms. One of the first things he does is to put through an emancipation reform, 1861. Does that sound familiar? Did you watch the Civil War series on television, the Emancipation Proclamation, 1863, here in America? Well, the same thing happened in Russia. This was liberalizing and freeing, if you will, the serfs who have been bound to the land in a feudal system for centuries and centuries. Alexander also spurred industrialization and the modernization of the Russian army, liberated Bulgaria from the Ottomans in 1877, and unfortunately was himself assassinated by terrorists in 1881. Alexander III, his son, was less liberal but more peaceful. This gets us to Nicholas II. Nicholas II is 1894 to 1917. He's the last czar. Now, I know when you hear Russian Revolution, everybody thinks of 1917. There were two revolutions, really. There was a revolution of 1905. 1905, that's 12 years before the whole thing with the Bolsheviks and so forth, which also were young Russian intellectuals agitating for more freedom and for more reforms in their country. Nicholas actually did put through quite a few reforms. Freedom of speech and assembly, the legalization of political parties. There'd never been political parties before in Russia. It had been either you're for the Tsar or against the Tsar. And being against the Tsar was very dangerous to your health, if you know what I mean. Elected legislative body, the State Duma, for example, was resurrected. And there were terrific agrarian reforms, what was called the Stolypin agrarian reforms. It's very possible that Nicholas might have been able to hold on to the country, stabilize things, but for World War I. Right about this time, as you know, World War I begins in 1914. Russia joins the Triple Entente. They join England and France and the Western countries versus the Central Powers, that would be Germany and the Austro-Hungarian Empire and the Ottoman Empire. And Russia now is in a major war with these countries. The reason why they were encouraged by England and France was, well, if we can hold them on this end here by opening up a front from this side, Russia can squeeze them from this side, we can squeeze them from this way, and we'll be able to win the war. That was the Allied thinking at the beginning of the war. Unfortunately, of course, this was just disastrous for the Russians. They lost a tremendous amount of men. They did not have sufficient equipment. Each soldier was issued two bullets. That was it. Any other ammunition you could find would be very nice, but you were only issued two. But what are you going to do with two bullets and a bayonet? You know, it was not a very healthy situation. As a result, Russia actually withdrew from the war, March 3rd, 1918. There's a treaty called the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk. Now, some scholars believe that Russia's withdrawal was pushed by and helped by the Germans. The reason they say that is that at that time, Lenin had been exiled by the Tsar, by Nicholas II, And where was he in exile? He was in Germany. The German government contacted this Russian emigre and said, look, if we send you back into Russia, finance you, we want you to open up a fifth column, make trouble for the Tsar so that Russia will not be able to fight us. They got him back into Russia just about at that time. So some scholars believe at least one of the factors was that Lenin had come back into the country and was in fact stirring up difficulty for the Tsar, and eventually the Tsar said, okay, there's no way that we can stay in the war. Nicholas, of course, as you know, was later on assassinated along with his family. There are really two acts to the Russian Revolution. February of 1917, the Tsar abdicated and actually was under house arrest until July of 1918, when he is and his entire family were executed by the Bolsheviks. There were people running around Europe claiming to be the lost daughter, Anastasia. You know, there's lots of stories about that. I think they eventually did a genetic test and found out that this person really wasn't related to them at all. It was a terrible tragedy, but you have to look at it from the point of view of the Bolsheviks. If they let the Tsar alone, if they just kept him under house arrest, he could perhaps make trouble for the Bolsheviks. There were people who worshipped the Tsar, who believed that the Tsar and that kind of government was the way that Russia should be. So if they had let him live, there was a possibility, in fact, that there would be some sort of a counter-revolution. In fact, for many years, for a good 5 or 6 years, there was fighting between 1917 and 1922 between the Reds and the Whites. If you ever read more about Russian history, you know that the Whites represented the Tsar, and the Reds, of course, were the ones who were trying to push a communist system together. For a while, it looked as though there could be a coalition government. A provisional government, in fact, was installed in February of 1917. But by October of the same year, that's why when they talk about the Russian Revolution, they say the October Revolution, they mean October 1917. Vladimir Lenin overthrew the provisional government and created what came to be known as the Soviet Union. 15 different republics, which had been absorbed and pushed into the Russian orbit over the years. There was a civil war, as I said, from 1917 to 1922, the Reds versus the White. Lenin died in 1924, cancer, unexpectedly. No plan left behind of exactly what to do when the great leader left. So they established a troika, a group of three men, one of which was Lenin, the second of which was a man named Trotsky. Some of you may have heard that Trotsky later was exiled and went to Mexico and was assassinated there in the country of Mexico. There were purges that took place because Stalin eventually took over in 1929 and made the country basically under his own control. So from 1929 to 1953, for quite a long time, Stalin was in complete control of the country. He established the secret police, the NKVD. He established what came to be known as the planned economy, industrialization, collectivization of all agriculture. And this led to tremendous famines and a great deal of difficulty for the people. Millions were deported eastward, and the Gulag Archipelago was essentially set up, a series of prisons right across Russia, all the way to Siberia, to put those who would not listen to what Stalin had to say. Keep in mind that Russia traditionally had been a simple agricultural nation. They had no real background in industrialization. They had to copy it from the Americans, from the Germans, from the British, from wherever they could. When Stalin came in, he said, look, doing this individually, each farmer having his 10 acres, isn't going to work. We have to pull them all together. And he invented the collective farm. We're talking something on the average of square miles as opposed to square acres. And a body of people that would be drawn together, maybe 3,000 or 4,000 farmers, put together almost like an army in battalions and squads. And their job was essentially to till the land, grow the crops. When the crops came, they were turned over to the government. And the government would take these crops and distribute them and sell them and do things like that. They would provide only just the necessary services to keep those farmers alive. Naturally, there's not much incentive in that. If you know full well that the result of all your labor is going to go to the state, Are you going to really labor very, very hard to produce as much as you can? Are you going to think of ways of doing better agriculture, doing better irrigation, doing better seeds? Of course not. So the agricultural collectivization idea didn't really go over very well. You know, strangely enough, at about the same time, a later run timer in the 1950s, they tried the same thing in China. Likewise, did not work. Mao Zedong's collectivization programs did not work either. But in Russia, at this time, Stalin tried to push that. Same thing with the factories. Instead of each individual factory making something, they put the factories together, again, with large numbers of factory workers, trying to produce heavy equipment, tractors and tanks and all that kind of thing. Well, just like with World War I, what comes along to complicate the whole situation? World War II. Germany and Japan became allied. There were fights along the Soviet-Japanese border in 1938 and 39. And in 1939, August of 1939, a non-aggression pact was signed with Hitler. Stalin reasoned that sooner or later, Hitler was going to come in his direction. He believed very strongly that Hitler would try to conquer all of Europe, yes, but he knew, just like Napoleon, sooner or later, they're going to start looking our way. So he actually signed a non-aggression pact with Hitler, saying, okay, we won't attack you. In other words, you won't have an Eastern Front to have to fight Germany if you don't attack us. That was signed in August of 1939. What happened September 1st, 1939? The invasion of Poland, right? The beginning of what we call World War II on the continent. The war had started much earlier in China and in other places in the Far East with the Japanese. But as far as the Germans were concerned, it started September 1st. But in August, Stalin, trying to cover his bases, trying to cover his bets, signs the documents with Adolf Hitler figuring, okay, this will give us some breathing time while Hitler is bombing the business out of the French and the English and so forth. Stalin did not trust at all. He would build up his military and expand his spheres of influence. It was at this time that they occupied the Baltic states. Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, which I'll tell you about on the 19th of October, these three countries were occupied by the Soviet Union to protect them from the nasty Nazis. That was 1939. They never let go of them until 1991. They were protected all right, but certainly they were now not allowed to leave either, even after the war was over. All that was well and good until, of course, Hitler broke his promise. 22nd of June, 1941. Hitler broke the pact, invaded the Soviet Union. And essentially, in the beginning, initially, the German army rolled through Russia like a hot knife through butter. But there were tremendous battles fought. Battle of Moscow, 1942. Battle of Stalingrad in 1942 and 43. The Siege of Leningrad, 1941 and 44. All three of these produced German defeats. And in fact, overall, this whole war, World War II, was called the Great Patriotic War. That's what it says in the Russian textbooks, the Great Patriotic War. Russia suffered more than any other country. If I know when you see the pictures of London and the Blitz, and you see what happened to France and what happened to Holland and the incredible Holocaust pictures, everybody says, oh my God, you know, these people took a tremendous beating. But the Russians also suffered extraordinarily. For example, military casualties alone, 10.6 million military, army and navy and Air Corps died. Civilians, 15.9 million. And those are conservative estimates. Remember, in a war, chaotic system like that, like this system, you don't get really accurate counts. But even so, that adds up to something like 26 million people. That's more than the population of all of New York State, for example. It was extraordinary. And the Soviet forces, of course, eventually gained the upper hand, pushed from the east as the Allies pushed from the west, the June 6, 1944, what they call Normandy invasion, put the Allied powers on the mainland in 1944. And from the east, the Russian soldiers and Russian forces pushed and pushed and pushed and showed up in Berlin. In fact, it was a race to get into Berlin before the Western soldiers, the Western powers, could get in. Likewise, too, in August of 1945, the Soviets pressed down into what is now Korea. and the northern parts of China, because just about that time was when Japan was being defeated. And you might remember the atomic bombs, August 6th and August 9th, 1945, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The Russians essentially had taken advantage of the fact that the Americans had essentially defeated the Japanese and had in those areas. Post-war. What happens after World War II? Well, Russia becomes, or the Soviet Union becomes, the second nuclear power on the planet. I think I told the story when we studied about Japan and the Far East Unit about the use of the atomic bombs. This is August 1945. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt died in April of 45. His vice president, who never expected to be president, especially standing in the shadow of such an incredible figure as FDR, a guy named Harry Truman, now found himself in the White House. His generals came into him in August of 1945 and said, listen, the Japanese are all but defeated, but if we invade Japan by sea, as we had to do in many cases, like the Philippines, you know, those kinds of amphibious landings, we estimate it's going to cost 1 million American lives to do that. And we estimate that there will probably be 5 million Japanese lives lost, because you know that the Japanese will fight for every single square inch of their homeland. Mr. President, there are some scientists in New Mexico who think they have a weapon so terrible that it will virtually incinerate an entire city, 500,000, 750,000 people like that. We call it an atomic bomb because we've been able to figure out how to actually split an atom and release this terrific energy. Nobody's ever really tried it. We've tested in the desert, vaporized quite a few jackrabbits, but we don't know what's going to happen when this is actually dropped on human beings. There's also the moral element of it. Should we, as Americans who try to be moral, decent people, use something like that on another people, even our enemy, the Japanese? It was Harry Truman's decision whether or not to use the atomic bomb. Truman thought about it and thought about it and thought about it, and took him a good week to actually send his word down to the generals and saying, okay, let's try it. Pick one city, just one, an industrial center, something that is making war materials, something that we can justify as a military target. They said, okay, Hiroshima. Hiroshima is in a bowl. It's geographically in a bowl. When the bomb is dropped, it will level the city, and we think, we don't know, but we think it's going to contain most of the radiation. August 6, 1945, Enola Gay, the B-29 bomber, dropped the bomb, and in a blinding flash, 500,000 people died, and the city was absolutely vaporized. Well, you can imagine the horror involved in that. And they waited, and they waited for the phone to ring, and the Japanese did not surrender. We expected, Truman expected, his generals expected, that after seeing this kind of power, the Japanese would naturally give up. They didn't. 3 days later, the second nuclear bomb was dropped on Nagasaki. Again, city vaporized. After that, as you know, the Japanese sued for peace. The treaty was signed September the 2nd, 1945, on board the battleship Missouri, General Douglas MacArthur presiding. That opened up the genie. The bottle was now open. And once the atomic bottle had been opened, other countries like Russia, and nowadays, as you know, quite a few countries have that nuclear ability. There's a lot of debate about whether or not the Iranians are trying to make a bomb. The technology now, you can imagine, is far more advanced and far quicker and far more destructive. The bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki is a mere firecracker compared to the average, just the average megaton yield of the nuclear stockpiles of most of the countries that are there. So essentially, by using that weapon, as terrible as it was, to get the Japanese to surrender, it also opened up a whole other galaxy of problems and a whole other range of possibilities. What happens if a crazy person, if a crazy country, if a man who has no compunctions whatsoever, who just wants to destroy his enemy at all costs, decides to use one of these weapons, and the collateral damage would go on and on? By the way, besides the blast effects, there's also the radiation effects. There are still many, many, many Japanese people who have genetic damage to them and are passing these genetic things down from generation to generation. Tendencies toward leukemia, for example, different kinds of biological problems that people develop as a result of this. And all that was 1945. That was 70 years ago, okay? Now, that's why when the Soviets got the bomb, people began to say, oh my gosh, what have we done? Now the Soviets have that capability as well. As you know, after the war, Nikita Khrushchev came to power. The old hero of Stalin was gone, and Khrushchev essentially decided that he was going to de-Stalinize Russia, denounce the cult of personality that had been built about Stalin, tried to, what he called, reform the penal labor system. Some released and rehabilitated, what's known as the Khrushchev Thaw. Probably some of you remember the title, the name Cold War was invented during the time of Nikita Khrushchev. Neither side, it was a funny thing, but it was taught to me in school, MAD, M-A-D, Mutually Assured Destruction. Neither side, the Soviets or the Americans, now having ICBMs that could deliver a nuclear weapon over thousands of miles, neither side wanted to use that button, but they used it essentially as a counterweight, one against the other, like two wrestlers engaging each other, each looking for a small opening to defeat the other. This came to be known as the Cold War. During this time, the Soviet Union also expanded into the area of technology. I remember distinctly Mr. Minato, who was my science teacher, coming into class in October 1957 and holding up a newspaper which had a picture of a little Russian grapefruit flying through space called Sputnik. And he said, ladies and gentlemen, the world has changed forever. We are now in the space race. What are you going to do about it? The Russians beat you. He challenged us, and sure enough, during the 1960s, remember John Kennedy saying, we will put a man on the moon by the end of the decade, and it was done. He was dead by that time, but still, that challenge technologically. Who would think that Russia, a backward agricultural nation of serfs, would now be competing with us, the Americans, the forward-looking Wright brothers, it's true. The Soviet Union actually did compete with us quite successfully, at least in the beginning. You might remember that Yuri Gagarin was the first man to orbit the Earth in 1961. All this happened during the time of Nikita Khrushchev, the fellow who beat the podium with his foot, with his shoe. There were also, how should I say here, signposts. Nothing in history happens in a complete vacuum. There's usually a precursor, there's usually something that's going to set off a chain reaction of some other event. One event triggers another, which takes into this, which causes this. They're all related, it is all put together. For example, in 1956, the Hungarian people rose in rebellion against the Soviet authorities that had been installed there, and there was a Hungarian revolution. The Western world ignored it, and in fact, the freedom fighters, the fighters that were trying to get rid of the Russians in Hungary, were destroyed. I know a lot about that because one of my closest friends growing up in school was a fellow paperboy. His name was Michael Thayer. And Michael and his family had escaped out of Hungary, getting into Austria, the way some of these people are trying to do now to get out of, get through Hungary, the Syrians. And he'd gotten into Austria, and from Austria he'd gotten to the United States. And he spoke about with us. He told about people in the streets with glass bottles and gasoline and strings on them and Molotov cocktails, hurling stones at the Russian tanks. Hurling stones at the Russian tanks. Unbelievable stories, and all of this had actually happened. Let me try and explain. When the Soviets came eastward As they drove the Germans back, they made sure that each one of the Eastern European countries, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Romania, Bulgaria, Hungary, that a Soviet-style communist dictatorship would be installed there. Those countries would therefore be, quote, satellites. That's why you hear about the Russian satellites. I don't mean the space ones. I mean the ones on the Earth, would be now controlled by the Soviet Union. After the war, the Western European countries got together and invented what they called NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. As a counterbalance to that, the Russians invented the Warsaw Pact, signed in Warsaw, Poland. And along with the Warsaw Pact, guess what? You got four or five Russian divisions stationed in your country, whether you liked it or not, just to make sure that you'd be protected against those NATO monsters. And also, who could be called out should you decide to rebel against the communist government. That's what happened in Czechoslovakia also, what's called the Prague Spring in 1968, and of course the Hungarian Revolution 1956. They were put down by the Russians, who had the tanks and the mobility and the people, the troops stationed in the country already, a Trojan horse type of thing. Okay, that's how they kept control of things. And that worked pretty well for quite a while. Something else I have to tell you about. Remember Ronald Reagan making his speech when he came to Berlin? He said, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall," the Berlin Wall. Okay, have any of you ever been to Berlin at that time? Okay, did you see the wall? It was the most obnoxious thing. Barbed wire and machine guns and people every day risking their lives trying to get just from one side of the city to the other. Unbelievable. Well, when the wall came down, of course, that also showed that communism was not going to continue to work. By the way, the East Germans and the Soviets called that wall an anti-fascist protection rampart. Right. Anti-fascist protection rampart. I always thought that was good phrasing. How about the Cuban Missile Crisis, 1962? I told you I was a ham radio operator. In 1962, I was a junior in high school. That tells you how old I am. I'm rather ancient. And at that time, being a ham operator, we always like to use our ability in radio and communications to help out, you know, our local facilities, local people. The Red Cross, for example, or when they had some sort of a drive or a run or those kinds of things, we were there. And I was connected to the civil defense. At that time, they called it the civil defense, okay? And had the triangle with the CD in the middle of it, if you remember those days. And my job was to maintain the radios, to make sure the radios were working at the civil defense headquarters in Patchogue. Now, do you remember bomb shelters? Right, okay. The civil defense headquarters had a bomb shelter literally in the basement, which went down 20 feet underground, 6 feet of reinforced concrete on all sides of the thing, shielded like you wouldn't believe. I got a phone call in October of 1962. They said, "John, after school today, get on your bicycle." I couldn't afford a car. "Get on your bicycle and come on down to the CD headquarters. Something important is going on. We want you to be here." When I got there, the director of the civil defense, who was a rather interesting, nice guy, said with a completely straight face, "We want you to check the batteries on all the radios. We want you to check the water. We want you to check the bandages. In other words, go through all the supplies that we have here. Do we have enough cots? We think there's going to be a nuclear exchange with the Soviet Union. We are 60 miles east of New York City. You know that New York will be a target. We will be collateral damage. We have to be ready." Now, to be honest with you, when you're 17, and the next four words made my blood freeze, "This is no drill." We had drills before, but when he said, "This is not a drill, this is the real thing," whoa! I did my job, made sure the batteries were done, all that, you know, got everything ready, and then, as you know, a couple of days later, John Kennedy was able to, through the United Nations with Adlai Stevenson, who was our representative at that time, get the Russians to back down and withdraw the missiles from Cuba. Gee, I'll see my graduation day, you know? You know, and maybe I'll get to go to college. But that was a real thing. It was not a joke. We were really terrified because we thought that this would actually occur. And that kind of brinksmanship, of just coming right up to the edge and just trying to see what the other guy is going to do. This has been something that the Russians have been doing for quite a while and are still doing with us. Gorbachev, of course, Khrushchev was the fellow involved in that, and he was deposed from power in 1964 by the Politburo. Leonid Brezhnev comes along next, 1964 to 82. His prime minister was Alexei Kosygin. A period of collective rule was going on. In the 1970s and 80s, this is a time of actual stagnation. Kosygin actually put through a reform program to try and decentralize the Soviet economy, a shift from heavy industry and weapons to light industry and consumer goods. All that was going on at that time. The Soviets went into Afghanistan in 1979 and stayed for 10 years. The idea being, again, geography, geography, geography. Why would the Soviet Union, this big country up here, be interested in coming into Afghanistan? Well, at that time, the Afghan government, which had been friendly to Russia, was overthrown. And the Russians felt that they should make sure that their southern flank, which is their weakest side, would be secured better if they came in. And so for 10 years, in 1979 and 1989, they came in and tried to secure Afghanistan for themselves. The ultimate plan was to push further south into Pakistan, and from Pakistan, of course, access to the sea through the Arabian Sea. These guys are chess players. You know the Russians love chess. They know which pieces to move on what squares down the line. If you play chess at all, you know that you have to play at least three or four moves ahead of where you actually are on the board at any given moment. And that was the play. Who was fighting the Russian forces? The Taliban. Uh-oh. Taliban, to Americans, those are the bad guys. But at that time, they were the good guys. They were fighting against the Russians. Who supplied the Taliban with the anti-tank weapons to knock off the Russian tanks? We did. The enemy of my enemy is my friend. Right? So you see, what comes around goes around. What goes around comes around. In this particular case, later, when they were driven out and the Taliban took over, we realized that that was a worse regime than if the Russians had jolly well taken over the place. The Russians we knew how to deal with. These guys were a whole different story. Mikhail Gorbachev comes in 1985. For 1985 to 1991, liberalization, there's the glasnost and the openness, the perestroika restructuring, trying to change things over, go to a more open economy, go to a more open society. In fact, Gorbachev actually won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1990 for his attempts to open up his country and to make the Soviet Union more liberal. He had many summits, summit agreements and summit meetings with Ronald Reagan. But by December 25th, 1991, the Soviet Union dissolved into 15 post-Soviet states. What happens next if the great system is gone? One of the things I did when I had my classes is that I would bring students from other parts of the world into my high school world history class. And we were thankfully graced enough to be able to get some Soviet students. Now remember, at this time, this is the Cold War, okay, even before 1991, to come from the State University of New York at Albany. These were language students. And at that time, the Soviet Union was very interested in getting people trained to speak other languages, especially English, German, yes, Chinese, Spanish, because they knew that their country would have to deal with these other areas. They were trying to spread their influence and so forth. And especially, they wanted to train their young people to be able to speak, read, and write English with great facility. There is an institute. It's called the Institute, the Maurice Torres Institute of Foreign Languages in Moscow. It's the premier college for Russian kids who want to learn languages in other countries, and we have of other nations. And we had four of these students come along with their moderator. We later found out, of course, the moderator was KGB. And if the students didn't say the right thing, they'd be on a plane home like that. But anyway, they came.
Is this the University of Albany?
Yes, the State University of New York at Albany. Right. Albany State, we called it in those days, right? Is that your alma mater too?
No, my wife went there.
Your wife went there, excellent, okay. Well, tell her there's a fellow green gremlin here, okay? But anyway, we had these students come out. It was quite a revelation. I remember going to see my principal and saying, look, I'm going to try and get some of these Russian students, these Soviet students, to come. And the principal looked up from his desk and said, for God's sakes, don't let them defect here. For God's sakes, don't let them defect here. He was afraid because, you know, there have been people from the Soviet Union, the ballerina people and athletes and all kinds of people who, once they get out of Russia, get into the United States, walk into an FBI agent office and say, I want to defect, I want asylum, I want to stay here. And my principal was afraid of that. It didn't happen, but that was his first thought. We had some very interesting discussions with these kids. My students would ask him, well, how do you feel about the space race? And they'd look at each other and say, race? What space race? We're not competing with the United States in space. We're peacefully exploring the outer galaxies and the space. Of course not. Right? Okay. The kids would ask him about religion. And they said, well, when I was a young person, they would take us on field trips, and we would go to St. Basil's and other churches, and the guides would say, well, this is a museum now. This is where people used to believe in all these fairy tales. We now have Soviet realism and Soviet truth. And obviously, there's such a beautiful, you know, artistic thing here, but you have to look at it from an artistic point of view. Don't believe all these crazy myths and stories and things that are out there going on. These Soviet kids we had could tell you the passing average of every NFL quarterback, the earned run average of every American baseball pitcher of any note in any team in any league. They knew American culture so well. Wasn't there a television series or something like that? right? The Americans, it's called, okay? Which was about a couple of deeply planted Soviet spies that had came to live in the United States and were thoroughly Americanized. Well, these students really knew our culture very, very well, much more than we knew about them. So I wanted you to understand that in those days, even though the Cold War was on, the Russians felt it was necessary to understand at least their adversary of the United States. Privatization of enterprise. Boris Yeltsin comes in after Gorbachev and the Soviet Union folds up. For 9 years, from 1991 to 99, privatization of enterprises from state agencies to individuals. The problem is that these individuals were very corrupt and would essentially set up their own governmental, their own businesses to satisfy themselves, not really to do any good in the economy overall. There are armed conflicts at this time in the 1990s in the Northern Caucasus. Chechen, for example, the separatists. I'll tell you more about that a little bit later on. Where does Putin come in? Putin comes in 1999. 31st of December 1999, Yeltsin resigned. His prime minister, Vladimir Putin, becomes the president. Then in 2000, they had elections. Now, Soviet elections, of course, are very interesting, okay? One candidate. Their election turnout is extraordinary. 99.9% all the time. Compare that to our election turnouts, okay? Because it's illegal not to vote, you see, okay? So the election, of course, in 2000, Putin won the election in 2000, hands down, and became the actual president of the country. Putin took power right away. As I told you, he'd been a lieutenant colonel in the KGB. He put down the Chechen insurgency. Grozny is the capital of Chechnya. Grozny, that city was leveled, absolutely leveled. It looked like Hiroshima when they got done with it. Even though they didn't use an atomic weapon, they absolutely leveled that city in the year 2001. Reforms, criticizing the West. Criticizing by the West that they were undemocratic, but these reforms helped the economy grow again. 9 straight years, improved the standard of living, got investments in, return of order, stability, and progress, won Putin widespread admiration. Many people say, well, how can they go along with this guy? He's such a dictator, he's such a this, he's such a that. The fact is, he's getting things done. He's getting the economy going again. People are getting employed. Things are moving. Now, I know that sounds familiar, doesn't it? He made the trains run on time, you know. There were many Germans in the 1930s who felt that Herr Hitler, despite his strange political leanings, was a good man because he had put Germany back on top again. It was active. It was people were working. They were rising up. They weren't going to have to take any more guff from those lousy Frenchmen. They had been humiliated in World War I, and here Herr Hitler was putting things back together. Sometimes people are willing to put aside their qualms about a leader if he's getting things done, if he's getting that employment going, if he's getting the economy going, if the housing is improving, if the food situation is getting better. On the way back to the university, I went over and picked these guys up in my car. On the way back to the university, we had the advisor with us and the kids. I said, is there any place you'd like to see while we're out here? And of course, we have a beautiful, I don't know if you've ever been to Albany, but we have this extraordinary South Campus, incredible, you know, buildings and so forth for the state government. They said, no, we want to see a supermarket. Yes. I took them to what was then called the Grand Union. Okay. Now, this was not a big Walmart's, you know, the big super-duper Walmart supermarkets. This was just a small, basic supermarket. They went bananas. They got their cameras out. For example, the first thing they went to was the meat counter. They could not imagine that you had every kind of meat available right there in the thing, fresh beef and pork and chicken and everything else. One of the kids told me, well, you know, we get these tickets and you can go and get 1 pound of meat per week. That's it. And you go to the butcher shop, present your ticket, and he will give you what he has, not what you want. If he happens to have pork, you get pork. If he happens to have chicken, you get chicken. If he happens to have cat, you get cat. You know, but because sometimes he says, we don't really know what it is, if you know what I mean, okay? They ran up and down the aisles. They were astounded by the variety. One kid tells me, you know, I counted 200 kinds of soup. 200 kinds of soup, can you imagine that? And they're taking pictures like crazy. Well, what happened was the manager came out. He thought we were spies. From Hannaford. I had to try and explain to him, though, these kids honestly just wanted to see. But the sheer variety that was there, the fruits, the vegetables, fresh, right there. Again, those kinds of things.
What year was that?
1989. It was before the fall of the Soviet Union. Okay? And so it was. I wanted you to understand that from their perspective, this was just incredible for them to see. One of my friends, for example, went to Russia, and he was in a store. His watch broke when he was over there, wouldn't you know it? And he went into a shop to buy a watch, and they showed him three different kinds of watches. And neither one of them really looked very good to him. He said, well, you know, do you have anything else? He said, no. But there's another watch store. There's another jewelry store, watch store down the block. Go there. He went there, they had the same exact three watches, okay? He went to a third place, same exact. Well, after a while, he says, what's the story? Those are the only three watches that are allowed to be manufactured. That's all that's available, period, okay? So things were very, very limited at that time. And even after the fall of the Soviet Union, when things were supposed to be liberalized, it took quite a long time for the economy to get to a point where they would have those kinds of varieties of fruits and vegetables and other kinds of things where they could buy, for example, different kinds of watches or television sets or cars. That was another whole thing, automobiles. The Russian students were just amazed by the variety and the, you know, the parking lot. You know, there they are running up and down the rows in the parking lot taking pictures of cars, you know. And again, you know, I'm glad the police didn't show up because they would have figured that these guys were going to break into these cars later or something. But the fact was they were just amazed by what they saw. And I thought that was very telling of the situation that they were in. Putin, of course, did return things to order. In 2008, Putin and Medvedev did the flip-flop. Medvedev became the president. Putin became the prime minister. 4 years later, in 2012, Putin became the president. Medvedev became the prime minister. And that's the way it'll stay until 2018. There are elections scheduled now for 2018. I have a whole page of the stuff that happened in Ukraine. I will tell you more about that. But basically what happened was that in 2014, in February of that year, their president, the Ukrainian president, Viktor Yanukovych, was thrown out of power by his own people. Yanukovych had made secret agreements with the Russians, to his advantage, of course, and to the Russians' advantage, for the sale of natural gas and for mining interests and that kind of thing. He fled into the eastern part of the Ukraine. And in that particular part of the Ukraine, there are Russian people of Russian ethnicity. The Russians decided that they would support Yanukovych, and they sent in troops and people, equipment, without markings. I don't know if you noticed on television when they showed these eastern Ukrainian forces, there was no markings. There was no insignia, nothing on them or even on their vehicles that identified them as Russian. It was very clear. In fact, a few months later, remember that airplane that was shot down? Civilian airliner cruising at 37,000 feet, shot down by a missile. Who do you suppose supplied the missile, right? Irregular forces with AK-47s and a couple of armored vehicles are not going to have the capability of knocking down a liner at 37,000 feet. The excuse was they thought it was a bomber. At 37,000 feet, okay? That, of course, precipitated a terrific amount of outpouring from the world community. And in fact, Putin himself decided to put the brakes on things and withdraw some of the aid that had been sent to those things. In March of 2014, they annexed, of course, the Crimea. And I will speak more of that when we talk more about Ukraine. How do we summarize all this? Well, first of all, when I'm going through all this, in the back of my mind, I'm saying, okay, what's the common denominators? What fits across all this from Yaroslav the Wise to Putin, from the dreams of Peter the Great to the extraordinary things of Khrushchev? First, influence of strong personalities, Yaroslav the Wise to Stalin to Putin. The personality cult. The leader provides stability, progress, employment, a focus for people to believe in. And that kind of strong personality, that sort of charismatic person, good or bad, has had a terrific amount of influence in Russian history. Influence of geography. At first, they're isolated from the West for quite a long time until they begin to reach out. There's conflict from the West, Sweden into the Baltic, Napoleon, later on Hitler. The vastness, the sheer size of a country like this. Difficult to govern, and perhaps the only way to govern something of that size was to have a very, very strong centralized system. Many Russians believe that because their country is so great, so big, that they cannot subdivide the governmental structure, that it has to be across everything. Access to warm water. I think I mentioned that to you, the Baltic Sea, the Black Sea, the Mediterranean. The Russians, over history, have always been trying to get to warm water, whether it's the Baltic Sea here, or down into the Black Sea here, or into the Sea of Okhotsk here. They're trying to get out. They feel themselves boxed in, and especially when it comes to naval forces and naval strength. Access to warm water, protection from Western pressures, military, economic, cultural. They need buffer zones. That's what they felt. That's why the Warsaw Pact was invented. Even in the Far East, China and Japan, especially in modern times since World War II, have to them been extremely strong barriers for them to expand into. For most of the Cold War, most of the 20th century, there was the Cold War. There is really a kind of a love-hate relationship. On the one hand, the Russians admire Americans, the Beatles in Moscow, and the Western culture. If you go to Moscow nowadays or you watch television carefully, you see the Russian kids, they're dressed up in the same things our kids are. You can't really tell the whole difference. And if you listen to their music, it's very, very Westernized in a lot of ways. They have admiration for our culture, for the way that we do things, for our freedoms. Tell you a quick story. You don't mind a story, do you? I've been telling stories all night. I'll tell you another story. I spent my life as a teacher. I am still teaching. And I went to a conference once in London, and it was an international conference of educators. And there were Russian teachers there, people who came from the Soviet Union, who were teachers of history. Interesting to talk to somebody else from another country, especially one of those. And we got to talking one night over coffee, and they said, well, teaching history in Russia is very, very easy. You have it much tougher than we do. And we said, why? Well, it's simple. We get a curriculum from Moscow. We get an actual curriculum, which tells us day by day exactly what we have to teach. No variations allowed. Okay? So if it is the 12th of December, all across the Soviet Union, from Belarus all the way to Siberia, everybody is doing this lesson. It's very simple, and you don't vary from that. We don't ask the kids to think. We want them to understand and to play it back to us. That's what we want. That's the object of education. You can imagine how me and some of the other teachers are sitting there going, oh my God, because our system makes kids teach. Maybe it's a little looser, maybe it's crazy, but it tries to make our people think about things. Yes, we tell them what we know about a certain topic, but we leave it up to them to decide what is right or what is wrong, what should be, what should not. In other words, there's some sort of a thinking process going on. In their system, there was no thinking allowed. Now, since 1991, things have changed a bit, okay? And many of the constituent republics that have broken away have adopted much more liberal educational systems because they're no longer under Moscow's rigid way of teaching, okay? And they are getting the kids to think. The problem is that sometimes this also leads to rebellion. It also leads to people who want to foment change, and sometimes they want change faster than it can really be done in that country at that time with the resources given. Even so, I think it's better to have that than to have that stagnation of rote learning in that respect. And that is part of this love-hate relationship. Admiration for things of the West. A fear of being un-Russianized. The fact is, the Russians have a very strong, beautiful, great culture. And the trouble is that sometimes they believe that if they absorb things from the West, they will lose some of their own. Okay? When I taught about Iran, if you were here for the Iranian lecture, you know that, for example, that's the Shah, Mohammad Reza Shah Pahlavi, who was the Shah of Iran for many years, introduced all kinds of Western reforms. For example, taking the shadur off of the women, allowing them to go to college. Iran had a Supreme Court justice, which is a woman. In Shiite Iran, that was unheard of. In other words, he'd institute a whole lot of things. But many, many Iranians felt that this was diluting their culture and that they were actually taking in some of the worst sides of it, because things like drugs, things like prostitution, things that were immoral and bad in their society, they felt was coming along with the good things. And that's why when they had the revolution in 79 and the Ayatollah Khomeini came in, a lot of the Western ideas went back. The women had to put the chadors back on, they were thrown out of the universities, everything went back to the 17th century. Now, it's not the same today. Things have liberalized quite a bit, but they were really afraid that they would lose their culture. Some of the Russians honestly believe that the more Westernization they take in, the more that their own culture will be lessened, and they will lose their identity. This idea of Mother Russia, that's very strong for them, very important. Keep in mind that they love their country. They really do. And just like we have feelings for our own nation, they have a great deal of feeling for their country, and they're afraid. They're afraid not just militarily, but they're afraid culturally that they might be overwhelmed by this terrific flood that's coming in from the outside world, which is very attractive, let's face it, especially to young people. They do have the arts. Think of it, the Bolshoi Ballet, the music, the literature, visual arts. Tchaikovsky, Rimsky-Korsakov, Borodin, wonderful composers. I put up a poster here for Dr. Zhivago. Remember that movie with Julie Christie and Omar Sharif? It's being made into a Broadway show. Did you know that? Yes, it's being made into a Broadway show. There is a terrific artistic cultural heritage there, which again, they want to protect. The difference between the Bolshoi and breakdancing. Follow what I mean? If too much of that stuff comes in, they believe that they will lose some of the real cultural heart that they've developed over many centuries of time. They do have the technology, the spacecraft, the aircraft, the submarines, all of these things. And there is also the rebellious minority peoples, for example, the Chechens that have been there, that have made a lot of trouble for their country. Remember I mentioned that everything's built around a personality. Good story. March 5th and March 16th of this year, 2015, Putin disappeared. My God. Every paper in the world speculated that he was ill, dead, having secret meetings with the FSB and the Chechen leader Ramzan Kadyrov. Was he overthrown? They even speculated he was attending the birth of his love child with Alina Kabayeva, an Olympic gymnast in Switzerland. So for 11 days, this guy disappears, doesn't make a public appearance, okay? Turns out he's meeting with the Kyrgyz president, Almaz Atambayev, near St. Petersburg. It just highlights how dependent they are on a particular single person. What if our president actually disappeared from view for 11 days? Can you imagine that? CBS would go into a hemorrhage. CNN would self-destruct, right? Because we're used to seeing our leaders all the time in prolific, if not maybe obnoxious detail, right down to what the guy had for breakfast. Well, here, Putin disappears for a couple of days, and whoa, there's lots of speculation as to what's going on. I mentioned Boris Nemtsov, who was the fellow who was criticizing our friend Putin for quite a while, was killed on the 8th of March, 2015. Anzor Kubashev and Zaur Dadiev, I have to practice those names, I hope you're impressed, who are residences from Chechnya, were arrested. The FSB, which is their police department, has cell phone and DNA evidence, they claim, from the scene and the getaway car. They believe that these guys were the ones who are responsible for Boris Nemtsov's killing. The question is, why would these two separatists from Chechnya happen to assassinate this particular guy who is criticizing Putin? There's some speculation, of course, that Putin or some of his friends were behind that. Update, as of this time, April of this year, the foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov, has begun to discuss openly with the United States some ideas about working. They're proposing to help against ISIS. Secretary of State Kerry and the foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov, went to have conversations leading to military-to-military talks on what to do in Syria. We would welcome constructive Russian support for the anti-ISIL coalition in Iraq and Syria, said our Secretary of State Kerry, but would Russia use this as a way to mount a defense of President Bashar Assad in Syria? Russia must be focused only on ISIL. So what's been happening is that the Russians have suggested openly that they would join in the coalition against the ISIL forces in Syria. The theory is, of course, that that would help to defeat them and bring more stability into that area. On the other hand, remember that Assad is a client of the Soviet Union, okay? The Russians have also been building up a naval base at Latakia, which is here on the coast of Syria, okay? And the question is, why are they putting more and more and more resources into that naval base on the coast of Syria? Do they wish to prop up Assad? Okay, if we accept their help in defeating the ISIS forces, isn't that a way of protecting Assad so that he will still be able to stay in power? It's from the Soviets, from the Russian point of view, it's to their advantage to keep him in power. They don't want to see him. Remember, this whole thing started as a civil war between people who were for and against Assad. The chemical weapons, that whole story. The fact is, the Soviets are now maneuvering, saying, hey, we'll help you with ISIS. You need some help, don't you, right? These guys are still destroying things in Syria and Iraq. We're saying, yes, but only if you concentrate on just working against ISIS. How we can do that is another question. How are we going to be able to channel the Russians to work on just that aspect of it? Keep in mind that all foreign policy is based upon national self-interest. What works for us, right? And we Americans feel, oh, we're doing the right thing with the guys with the white hats. Everything we do is going to be perfect, and we're doing the right thing for the right reasons. Keep in mind that from the Russian point of view, they're going to do things that benefit them. And if they commit people and resources, which are scant from their perspective, they want to make sure that they get a result that solves a problem for them, that does something that they want to see happen. So we're going to have to watch very carefully in the next couple of months exactly how this is going to play out during the fall. By the way, this week, Prime Minister Netanyahu of Israel will be meeting Putin during this week to discuss Syria, to see what's going to be going on there. I mentioned about the space program. Did you know that we buy Russian rocket engines, right? We've been using the rocket engines for about the last 10 years or so, which we buy from Russia to put our satellites up and also to send the supply ships up to the space station. There is a bill in Congress to stop that because they feel it's undermining the American space program because we're depending upon them. Why are we depending upon, quote, our enemy for rocket engines, which we need for our satellites and for resupplying the space station and so forth? The Pentagon has actually opposed that, saying, no, we need, for the time being, we need to buy those engines because we have to keep the program going, okay? Companies like Lockheed and Boeing are working feverishly right now to build our own engines. You know the whole Made in America thing? You know, I think, especially when it comes to the space stuff, my God, we have to buy rocket engines from the Russians to put our satellites up? It seems bizarre to me. Yes?
So what happened to NASA?
Yeah, NASA's still there, but NASA is tremendously underfunded. Their funding has been cut and cut and cut and cut. Ever since the shuttle program folded, you know, it's just the space program, unfortunately, has taken terrific hits that way. Part of that, of course, has been the expense of the military that's been in Afghanistan and Iraq and these other kinds of things. Some congressmen, like Senator John McCain, the chairman of the Armed Services Committee, does not want us dependent upon the Russian engines for military or for NASA purposes. Lockheed Martin, as I said, and Boeing have been using these engines for years, and they want to, of course, develop their own. But they need to get the contracts, and the contracts have to be approved by Congress. One last point. Remember I passed around the sheet that showed the European Union. This is an economic union, a union of countries in the Western world. And if you take a look at it, it also extends well into Eastern Europe as well. One of the things that the European Union and the United Nations has done against Putin, can't we do something to punish him for doing these nasty things, has been economic sanctions. In other words, taking away their ability to have credit overseas, banking, travel, those kinds of things that can be controlled, and especially which are prevalent in Western Europe. The European Union has signed and agreed in June of this year to continue the economic sanctions against Russia until January of 2016. 28 nations have blocked themselves against Russia's actions in the Ukraine. Moscow had lobbied hard to get these reductions done in light of their help with the Iranian nuclear negotiations. The Russians argue, look, we helped you get those nuclear discussions concluded with Iran, therefore you should lift some sanctions for us. The European Union said no, because those decisions require uniformity. In other words, there has to be unanimity, rather. Everybody has to vote together. Even countries like Greece and Cyprus and Hungary that usually kind of go along with the Russians on some things voted against them. The peace plan that's in place right now for Ukraine was agreed to in February 2015 in Minsk, and it must be implemented fully, the European Union says. Restrictions, access to capital on Russian banks and companies, asset freezes, travel bans. Of course, another thing that's hurt them terrifically has been the decrease in oil prices. I've been delighted to see the pump prices go down to $2.19. Oh my goodness, we should have a party, right? Well, this has also hurt the Soviets, the Russians, because they are an oil-producing country, and like the Saudis and other countries that depend upon oil revenues, those revenues have been going down. One last point. Russia lifted its ban on S-300 anti-aircraft missile systems for Iran. Sergei Lavrov, the Russian foreign minister, said that the proposed deal on the nuclear program eliminated any need for the ban on missile sales. Iran says that this will help to strengthen ties with Russia. So the Russians are going to send and sell anti-aircraft missiles systems to Iran. Okay? This is something else which doesn't really help the whole equation, but which the Russians want to do because it gives them, if you will, an in. It gives them some leverage with Iran, which, as you know, is a major country in the Middle East as well. To put it all together then, you've got a country that's immense in size. It is ambitious in its goals now, has been through a tremendous amount, has suffered extensively in its history, is trying to come back and be recognized as a major power. They keep stumbling because they don't really know how to deal with the West. And that's part of the reason why our diplomatic services, our Secretary of State, the United Nations, and others are working so hard to try and get the Russians to work along with us. Just imagine, throw your preconceptions out, completely out the window. Just imagine if Russia and the United States could work together. I mean, really work together on one thing, space, the conquest of cancer, international trade, immigration, just one thing. What could be accomplished? Immense things, great things, wonderful things. Thank you.